You can relate to that if you are born again. You know that God does minister to you marvelous and amazing ways, as we would call those moments in the spirit. It's a wonderful day to be in God's house. I just all of the things about this day and about this moment, I'm just trying to take in. To celebrate our mothers, grandmothers, and that was just an amazing moment. Amen. And to know that these are real people who do these real things. And every now and then we need to salute our women and highlight the things that they do in our lives in amazing ways. And say thank you. Amen. Nowadays people don't even want to say thank you. But we need to learn how to say thank you, and we appreciate mothers, women, what you have done, the words you have said, your love, your laughter, your tears, your struggles, your sacrifices. For all of that, as a church and even as a pastor, we want to say thank you. I realize the church cannot be what it ought to be without women. Amen. They have been the backbone of the church, although men don't readily say that, but it's true. Can't hide that fact. That's an obvious fact. They come to church. They support programs. They give. They serve in various ministries. And the church is just in a great debt of gratitude for what you have done. And we as a church ought to say thank you to you for being who you are. Amen. Amen. I don't know what God has done. He somehow just has connected, or women have connected with God in amazing ways that men have not. We failed to connect with God. And as a result, you can see it in our communities. I'm talking about among the men. Have I got a witness here? But women have connected in amazing ways. They found God to be their source of strength, especially when we were acting up. And they couldn't talk to us, couldn't talk to nobody else. They came talk to the Lord. That's a blessing. It's been a blessing for those who have been recipients of godly mothers, and women who have cried their tears about broken experiences and allowed God to put it back together. It's been a blessing to me. And there are other men who can say it's been a blessing to have mothers who knew the Lord. And you can see God in them, not when they were here on Sunday, but you can see God in them on Monday. And on Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, and just talking about and living for God. That is a blessing. Just jump in and say amen at any time. If you had a godly mother, you had a godly aunt, you had a godly grand, just say amen. You know, brothers ought to say amen. Thank God for a mama that was there. Because nowadays, some women, some children haven't even seen their mama. It's a different day and time today. And then not only that, they can't hear from their mama, and their mama can make promises, but mama don't come through. So a lot of us have had experiences that have made us all the better because mama came through. Mama was there. Mama went to school. Mama picked you up from school. Mama sacrificed her little old paycheck for you to get go where you need to go. Amen. So it's a great day. I'm excited. I'm thankful to God. My heart is so full about all of the wonderful things that have occurred today. And of course, I've had a great mother. And I can say that in so many ways. She's been a great first lady. She's been a wonderful wife to her husband. And she's been a strong mother. Raised us up in the right way. And I always tell people I've been raised right. It was all because of a lady by the name of Sister Beatrice West. And let me say this, women, although I know people say one is too many and two is plenty, you ain't gonna do no better than a baby. Let me say that well. I'll be by myself, because the amen meter went down. You will not do no better, because all of the accolades we can lay on people, they once were a baby. Nelson Mandela, he came from a mama. I hope you're not surprised. Kobe Bryant, he came from a mama. Shaquille O'Neal had a mama. You ain't surprised, are you? Martin Luther King. And go anywhere and talk about anybody, they wouldn't be here if they didn't have a mother. You say amen. Amen. Yeah, stop to think about it. I ain't got a long sermon. I got a short sermon. Amen. Amen. And I intended it to be that way. But I might get happy. I don't know. Y'all ain't saying amen. Yeah, y'all kind of stiff in the church. Amen. If you need to take an apple saucer before you get to church, take your apple saucer. Amen. We bring a whole lot of issues and attitudes up in the church, man. It's all right if you're going to leave them at the altar. But just to bring them, to showcase them, you all messed up, baby. You ought to bring them and leave them at the altar. You know that God can work it out, amen? I feel all right today. God is good all the time. I want to talk from the book of Ruth. It's a marvelous passage. And mothers, let me say it again. I can't say it enough. Happy Mother's Day. Women, celebrate who you are, amen, because you are a powerful force in our lives. And as one of my great philosophers said, maybe a man's world, but it's a miserable thing without a woman. You know who said that? Amen. Amen. Ain't nothing without a woman, amen. He right about it, too. Amen. Oh, I feel all right. The book of Ruth. Turn with me and look at this book and this woman. Just highlight some issues in her life this morning that I think is of some real importance to all women, and to remind them, of course, that God knows where you are and God is able to help you. And just to put the whole circumference of life in its proper context. Amen. Verse 11. And this is the verse is just first chapter, verse 11. Ruth chapter 1, verse 11. Thank you so much. Are you there? Amen. Say amen. Amen. If you're not, say wait. I think I might have heard of fainting wait. It's all right. It's in the Old Testament. Amen. Right behind the book of Judges, right before the book of 1 Samuel. It's a small book, but a marvelous piece of literature. Do yourself a favor and read her story, women. Amen. You ought to know and celebrate women of the Bible. Amen. Amen. All right, verse 11. But Naomi said, and she's saying again, turn back, my daughters. Why will you go with me? Are there still sons in my womb, that they may be your husbands? Turn back, my daughters. Go, for I am too old to have a husband. If I should say I have hope, and if I should have a husband tonight, and should also bear sons, would you wait for them till they were grown? Would you wait until they grew up? Would you restrain yourself from having husbands? No, my daughters. For it grieves me very much for your sake that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. Verse 14. Then they lifted up their voices and wept again. And Oprah kissed her mother-in-law. But Ruth clung, clave to her, is the old language of marriage. And she said, look, your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and to her gods. Return after your sister-in-law. But Ruth said, entreat me not to leave you or to turn back from following you. For wherever you go, I will go. And wherever you lodge, I will lodge. Your people shall be my people, your God, my God. Where you die, I will die. And there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if anything but death parts you and me. Now, isn't that a wonderful text? That's a beautiful text in biblical literature. That's a beautiful statement from a beautiful heart. I want to talk about Ruth on the real. Ruth on the real. What every mother knows, and possibly what some mothers need to know. Lord, bless our time together in the Word of God. Let your Spirit give us what we need to leave this place in a much more positive way under your care and lordship in Jesus' name. Can you say amen? Amen. Ruth on the real. You can actually do it either way. You know, you could say Ruth on the real or Ruth on the real, like the children say. Let's get real with it. Ruth on the real. What's real, Ruth? Tell us what it's all about today. Give us some advice for life and living. What every mother knows. Ruth, talk to us today. Ruth is a woman that is qualified to speak about having a man and not having a man. She knows something about cold sheets and no cash flow. She knows something about a mother-in-law who has issues, who was bitter and was speaking out of her bitterness. She knows something about a man leaving her unexpectedly and being left all on her own. She knows something about workfare, and she knows something about welfare. She knows something about the joys and pains of life. She knows something about the chills and thrills of life. She knows something about the ups and downs of life, the rights and wrongs of life. She comes to us in one of the most celebrated pieces of Hebrew literature, the book of Ruth, just four chapters. But during their festive days, they would read the story of Ruth. It appealed to them in various ways. Her life is one of tragedy turned into triumph, one of an ordinary person who emerges through turbulent times in the midst of deep hurt and turns it around into dynamic blessings. Ruth is an amazing woman. Her experience, she learns what's through her experience, she learns what's important in life. And you can learn what is important in life through experience. But the experience of others can be the best teacher. You know, experience is good, but it's better when it's somebody else's experience. And so Ruth can teach us some life lessons. She can talk to us about what is important in life. She's a mother that is experienced now, and we can listen to her lessons. And so I just want to peruse some lessons that Ruth would teach this morning. I want to talk about some things that she believes is important in the life of a woman. Is important in the life of a mother. Well, when I look at this book as a whole, the first thing that jumps out at me that is important in all of our lives is the importance of family. Family is important. I guess I've never seen more broken relationships than I've seen today, but family is important.
I see women abandon their children, women killing their children, women leaving their children on the doorstep. We seem to have lost the value of how important family really is. But Ruth says to us that family is important, and she gives us the proper perspective on family. If you've got the idea that family is going to always have a good time, if it's going to always be rosy, you got the wrong idea of family. Some of us have that romantic idea of marriage. A good marriage knows how to handle its problems. It is not that it does not have problems. It just knows how to handle those problems. And family is the same way. Family has its tragedies and its triumphs. And sometimes it has more tragedies than it does have triumphs. But you've got to understand how to handle yourself when you're going through a tragedy in your family. And Ruth knows how to handle herself going through this tragedy in her family. It was a downtime. It was a time in which Naomi was experiencing bitterness. But you really don't know who your family, what your family really is like when money is in your pocket. That's not testing time. You don't know what your family is like when the air condition is running. That's not testing time. You don't know what your family is like when your car and your house is doing fine. That's not testing time. Testing time is when you're down to your last dime. Testing time is when your car is not running. Testing time is when you're going through a difficult moment. Then you ask yourself, where is your family? And we can see in Ruth, she says to Naomi, where you go, I'm going. Whatever you go through, I'm going to go through with you. When you die, I'm going to die right there. In other words, we're family. And we're going to stick together, because sticking together breeds success. There is tragedy in family. There's also triumph. Family has or will be stretched, and family will be shaped. Pastor, what do you mean by that family is going to be stretched? You're going to go through some difficult times with family. Your brother is going to lose his job. Your sister is going to lose her job. And when they lose their job, they don't need to call you. You need to call them. If God's blessing your household, you need to be the one that steps up to the plate and say, how can I help you? You got to determine how you can help. But you ought to offer the help up front. Nobody needs to look for you when they're going through a difficult time in their family. You really can't say amen. Some of y'all may not be acting right with your family. But family is going to be stretched. You're going to be tested to your limits. But you got to remember that's your family. You got to remember this too will pass. Don't hold on to the tragedies. Don't hold on to the difficult moments. Hold on to the moments of celebration. It's going to be stretched, but family has to be shaped. When I leave the house, I say to my kids sometimes, they'll say, that, you know, they'll be looking at TV or whatever, and I'll say to Elijah, Elijah, what do I want you to do? He says, Dad, you want me to look after Mama? You want me to look after Elise? Now, he's not going to do a whole lot of looking. But I'm shaping. I wish I had a witness. Now, when it gets to be, you know, 21, 25 with that degree, it's going to come second nature, because I've already planted the seed, and the seed is going to germinate. And I won't have to say, look after Mama, look after your sister. That will just be what family does. Every time I put them to bed, I say, trust God, be strong, and Daddy loves you. I'm shaping. He hadn't got to the point that he understands or he can conceptualize God, but he can conceptualize Daddy, and he can trust Daddy, and he can watch Daddy be strong. And after a while, when he runs into the storms of life, he knows he doesn't have to, listen, he doesn't have to bow down. He may bend a little bit, but he'll realize that Daddy said, when you get in the storms of life, be strong. I'm shaping. That's all I'm doing. I know he's going to have some difficult moments. I know he's going to have a nasty boss. I know he's going to have some friends that back out on him. But I want him to know that in those moments, be strong. Just shaping. You got to shape family. Sometimes you got to share some things with family that's unpleasant. But it needs to be shared. Sometimes you got to get up in family face and let them know you out of order. That's not according to the family code. We stick together. When we need to put some money in the pot, everybody. I wish I had somebody. I might be by myself. Everybody got to step up to the plate and put what you can in the pot. And don't come up here talking about you can't give nothing. Yes, you can. When you were chasing that thing, you found some money. Hello, somebody. Every time your TV go out, you find some money. When your car break down, you find some money. Step up to the plate, because that's what family does. I told you Ruth had some lessons, didn't she? Second thing I see is, Ruth will tell us that family is important, but loyalty is important. The importance of loyalty. Some women want to be close to you, but they don't want to be loyal. Let me say that again. Yeah, what's up with that? You want to be all up in my business to put my business out. Have I got a witness? And you got some women who will perpetrate the friendship just to get an ear on what you're going through. Now that used to be a dirty word. I wish I had a witness. That's why people can't understand Linda Tripp. How you going to be all up in Monica Lewinsky's business and then put her business out like that? I don't care what you say. Some women understand you ain't supposed to do that. Help me somebody. Loyalty. You loyal to somebody. Don't be friends with a man and then you chasing his man. I mean his woman. And don't be friends with a woman and you chasing her man. That used to be a dirty word. I'm just being practical today. Have I got a witness? If you my friend, you ain't got no business looking at my woman. And if you're a woman's friend, you ain't got no business looking at her man. I'm going to get up out of here in a minute. Loyalty is a principle that's consistent. Make no commitment to the primary things in life, and it will be as if you have never experienced them. You got to be committed to your family, committed to your marriage, committed to your children. Commit yourself to something. I wish I had a witness. Other than the football game and the basketball game and the baseball game, commit yourself to something. Say that, listen, when this happens, I will be there. Make a commitment in life. We're scared to make commitments in life. Nowadays, women are scared to make commitments in life. It used to be, if you say a man, tell a man commitment, he was, I ain't ready yet. 50 and ain't ready yet. 60 ain't ready yet. Man, when you gonna get ready? I know I'm real. See, life has its seasons. The fat years, the lean years. There are good times, there are bad times. Money comes and goes. It goes in cycles. You don't determine your friendships by the money people have. You reap what you sow, and you sow what you reap. But loyalty remains consistent. Have I got a witness? That's why people write songs like, listen to this, you know, how you like me now. You know why he's saying how you like me now? Because you left me when you thought you didn't like me. You left me when my money was low. You left me in a bad time, but now things are rolling. How you like me now? They write songs like, I will survive. You thought I'd crumble and die. No, not I will survive. You walked out on me, told me I wasn't going to be nothing. You left me with these children, and then she had to get up in the midnight hour and write with tears in her eyes, I will survive. And then send him a certified letter with the song in it. Loyalty means something. Loyalty is about making choices and making the best out of your choices. You are the sum total of your choices. You decide what you want to do. You decide what you want to be. You decide the life you want to live. And you, let me tell you something now. If you're considering a major decision in your life, ask yourself, what are the consequences? And don't have this attitude, I don't care what happens. People say that before they go to jail. Before they go to the hospital, I don't care what happens. Yeah, you care what happens. You got a life to live. You got places to go, people to see, mountains to climb. You got things to conquer. You ain't gonna always be on the curb. I'm just talking. Consider your choice. You gonna lay with a dog? You gonna get up with some fleas? If they can milk the cow for free, I've told you, then wipe out a cow. Just consider your choices. That's all I'm saying. And there's so many things that's out there. We need to tell our youth, you need to look at where you're going. Check out what you're doing. You're the sum total of your choices. Character is, loyalty is all about character. And your character will carry you. There have been some situations, thank God, I made the right choice. Because had I made the wrong choice, I would have been a messed up brother and not standing up here before you. You've got to remember your character will carry you. You look at grandma, you look at your mother, you look at them doing right. Right will keep you out some places you don't want wrong to take you. That's real plain. It's real plain. It's tight, but it's right. Family, loyalty. Then the other lesson that Ruth teaches us is the importance of love. The lack of love in the winter life will make you bitter. Everybody in here needs some love. No love in the spring of life will make you sour. Nobody is exempt from love. This is an incomparable story of love with tenderness and beauty. The author tells of the faithfulness, listen to this, of a daughter-in-law to a mother-in-law. That's love. And you need love. I need love. We need love. Nobody gets outside of love. We are creatures to be loved. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. She loved her mother-in-law in the bitter seasons of her life. She didn't leave her. She loved her. And let me tell you this. Love will show its best impressions when things are going bad. You need to learn to love people when things are going bad in their lives. What they really need is somebody to stay there and love them. Though they may be acting a fool, though they may be acting silly, though they may be talking out the side of their mouth, they need, and they're trying to say, I need somebody to love me. You need love, I need love. Ruth shows love by her life and not by her words. We don't need people who will say I love you and walk out the door at the same time. No, we got too much of this lip love service. We need some action love service. Let your actions show you love me. As a matter of fact, give yourself a test and from the next week to next Sunday, let your actions show you love them. Do something that says to the person that's important in your life that you love them. Don't say you love them, do something. Because we've been talking too much about how much we love people and doing nothing. Her life showed she loved Naomi. It's a story of love lost tragically. And it's a story of love gained serendipitously. What do you mean, Pastor? Well, she lost her and Naomi, lost their husbands tragically. But Ruth gained love again serendipitously. She just kept getting up in the morning. She didn't decide to lay in her bed or feel sorry for herself. She just stayed involved with life, and life brought her to love's doorstep. I wish I had somebody. And all you need to do is stay involved in life. He left you or they died prematurely. Stay involved in life. And life will bring you to love doorstep. And so she finds love in the arms of Boaz. It is a story of a woman, of the arms of a woman being emptied instantly. And yet they are filled instructively. They are emptied instantly, but they are filled instructively. It's a young girl listening to an older woman. It's old school talking to new school. And you know what? A whole lot of young women would be much better off. And I don't think I'm too old to say this. If you would listen to some old school, you will learn a whole lot more about love and how love ought to be, how love, what love looks like, what love smells like, what love acts like, if you listen to an older woman. Sometimes you can be listening to some of these young girls and they're talking about love. It ain't love at all. But an older woman can talk to you about real love. Not drive-by love, not overnight love, not 7-Eleven love, not instant microwave love, real love. I'm talking about real love. Somebody who's going to stay with you, somebody who's going to stand by you, somebody who appreciates you for who you are, real love. We seem to have given up on that. Now youth have just inoculated themselves. They don't even want to talk about feelings. They just want to get with it. Let me get my groove on and leave. You can get silent. I know I'm right about it. I ain't got to know your last name no more. I really didn't get your first name when I came in the door. I just want to sweat and breathe and I'm gone. Don't talk to me about commitment. Don't talk to me about nothing lasting. You know, I'm just trying to do my thing. You trying to do yours. We both going to meet some needs, and I'm out of your life. That's not real love. But the fact of the matter, that's where a whole lot of people are. Stay with me, lights and walls. We've given up on it. We don't want to be committed no more. But we need to be committed to real love. Ray Parker wrote a song, "A woman needs love just like you do." Quit lying to yourself talking about you don't need no love. Women need love. Men need love. We all need to experience some real love. Heart and Soul magazine, a magazine that was issued for women, wrote an article entitled, "I Don't Need a Man and the Other Lies We Tell Ourselves." You don't have to tell that lie. You don't even have to involve yourself in that lie. If you meet somebody, you meet somebody. If you don't meet nobody, you don't meet nobody. But you understand what your needs are and you properly express them to God. I'm talking about real love. Family, loyalty, love. Ruth teaches us another lesson, the importance of faith. The importance of faith. When you look at this text, the journey you follow in life should be one of faith. The choices you make in life should be one of faith. The purposes you establish in life should be one of faith. The principles you embrace in life should be one of faith. Faith is what should guide your decisions. It should guide your choices. It should establish your purposes. Life is about what you believe. And if you don't know what you believe, just look at how you're behaving. If you believe in coming to church, you'll come consistently. If you believe in giving, you'll give consistently. Look at how you behave and you'll discover what you believe. Don't tell yourself you believe in God and you got no relationship with him. Because when you believe in God, you have a relationship with him. Some of us are just dropping by church today. It isn't about a relationship with God. Just get real with yourself. When you have a relationship with God, you wake up in the morning and talk to him. When you're going through a difficult situation, you will talk to him. Every now and then, you will listen to what he has to say. That's a relationship. Important lessons. Family, loyalty, love, faith. Your faith is important in guiding your lives. And if there's anything I would say to you, listen. When you go off to college, don't leave your faith behind you. I'm talking to you. Do not leave your faith behind you. Because there's going to be some ignorant, asinine, stupid, awful, ridiculous stuff done in college. I'm by myself. But you ought to be saying amen because some of your children are going there. I mean, Freaknik didn't happen all by itself. It evolved somewhere. When you go to college, take your faith with you. And don't be ashamed to tell somebody you believe in God. Be ashamed of some of them other things you do. That hooking and crooking. Dipping and dodging, that down low stuff. Be ashamed of some of that. But don't be ashamed to say, I believe in God. I accept Jesus as my Savior and Lord. And guess what? When you say it, it'll knock some of the crows away automatically. Some of the buzzards will fly off automatically. Matter of fact, you ought to wear it on your t-shirt, tattoo it on your arm. I believe in God. You won't get all them issues. Amen. I'm through. Finally, I want to talk about the importance of grace. Women, I can say this. The odds are stacked against you. You're double minority. You're woman and you're black. Sometimes we're born on the wrong side of the track. You can't afford to get up out of the bed on the wrong side. If you're born on the wrong side of the track, you got to get up every morning with some ups in you. You got to get up determined. You got to decide that you're going to change your situation. You got to decide that you're going to make the best out of your day. And listen, let me tell you something. Right now, you will not always get it right. No mother, I don't care how they try to perpetrate, they have not always gotten it right. You make mistakes with husbands. You make mistakes with your children. You make mistakes. Nobody gets it right all the time. The only person that ever walked this earth that got it right was Jesus Christ. But if you didn't get it right, you can always turn it around. You didn't get a chance to raise your children. Turn it around. You didn't get a chance to be a good mother. Turn it around. You can always turn it around. Don't feel sorry for yourself. Don't beat yourself up about it. Stop living in the past. Get over it. Men will leave you unexpectedly. You can give them good years. They'll still leave you. Children will be born rapidly. Sometimes your economic choices will be few. But remember grace. That's what I stopped by to tell you. Because behind every successful woman is grace. Behind every successful man is grace. Be glad that you're here. Do what you can. Fight with the gas that's left in your tank. And don't think it's all left up to you. God is on your side. That's what Ruth remembered. God's on my side. God ain't just in Moab. God is also in Bethlehem. So it doesn't matter where I go, God is going with me. People will exclude you, but God will include you. People will say your needs will never be met, but God can meet your every need. People will frustrate you to death and will make you sick, but God will bring you fulfillment. And just when you thought you were all alone, that nobody cared, the children are acting crazy, you can't find a half a man that you had, remember grace. God will be there. I wish I had a witness here. He's just like that. And when you go through things you thought you'd never make it, and you realize you did, remember it was grace. You raised those children and they came up right. Don't start the bragging without putting God's name in it. Because sometimes you wasn't with them. Sometimes you couldn't see them. But God took care of them. Remember grace. Grace will make people say, how does she make it? How did she make it through her adversity? How did she raise all those children? How did she do it with no job? How did she do it with a piece of job? Grace will make people say, how did she come this far? How did she get that job when she was the last one in line for it? How did she do it? Grace will make people say, how did she make it through school? How did she put those children through school? How is her back still straight? How does she have a smile on her face? You ought to shout and tell people it was the grace of God. I didn't know how, but I knew God could, and I knew he would. Grace. Grace in my tragedy. Grace in my triumph. Grace in my brokenness. Grace in my blessing, grace in my ashes, and grace when things are beauty. God's grace is just amazing. Some people said you couldn't have a baby, grace. Some people say you couldn't raise that baby, grace. Some people that said that child would never be nothing, grace. Thought you'd never get a home, grace. I'm celebrating. Thought you'd never get a promotion, grace. Thought you'd never pay it off, you got the pink slip, grace. Did it by yourself, grace. You didn't want to do it by yourself. You pleaded for him to stay, but grace. God's grace is important. And you can never leave God out of the equation. He's the one that made the real difference. Great mother, grace. Great woman, grace. A great life. Give glory to God. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Thurman, what is the real secret to being a great mother? God's grace. That's it. Because we all make mistakes. And some mistakes we make, God just keep covering up for those mistakes. Sometimes we get distracted and take our eyes off our children, but we know that God just covered up for that. Sometimes we say the wrong thing, but we know that God's grace just covers up for that. The secret of being a good mother, a great mother, is the grace of God. And that grace is expressed clearly in his son, Jesus Christ. And the real question that you ought to ask yourself this morning is, do I have Christ as my Savior and as my Lord? And if I don't have Christ as my Savior and my Lord, how can I share with my children Jesus Christ until I first experience him for myself? Say, preacher, I want to know Christ today as my Savior. I want to know him as my Lord. If you want to know Christ as your Savior, if you want to know him as your Lord today, you can do it by faith. You can say today, Jesus, come into my heart and make me the kind of person, make me the kind of woman you want me to be. Make me the kind of man you want me to be. Because I can't be the best woman or man without your son, Jesus Christ. You sent him that I might experience grace and truth. The secret really is Jesus Christ in your heart. But the question is, will you make that choice today? Because you will be the sum total of all your choices. Will you make the choice today to choose Christ as your Savior? As your Savior, as your Lord. Say, preacher, I'll make that choice. That's you, just raise your hand. I'll make that choice. Just raise your hand right where you are. Just say, I want to make the choice to choose Christ. I see you. As my Savior, I see you. Raise it so I can see you. I see you. I see you. As my Savior, as my Lord. I want to make that choice. I can't be all that I know I should be without Christ, without God. I want to make that choice. I'm going to pray with you. Saints of God are going to pray audibly. You can pray silently or audibly, but today trust Christ that he died on the cross for your sins, that he rose on the third day, and trust him to come into your heart as a living Savior to change your life. If you can do that today, he will save you. I'm going to pray it audibly. Saints of God are going to repeat after me. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Those who are really concerned about others being saved will follow instructions. I know that. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Come on. I'm going to pray audibly. Saints of God are going to pray audibly. You pray silently or you pray audibly, however you choose. Those who get the tape can choose to play audibly or silently. Let's pray. Let's ask Christ to come into our hearts. Heavenly Father, it's in the name of Jesus that I recognize that I need you. The real secret to living a successful life, to being a successful mother, a successful father, is the grace of God. And you've chosen to express your grace in your son, Jesus Christ. Today, I open my heart to experience Jesus Christ as my Savior and as my Lord. I confess that I haven't done right. I haven't lived up to your standards. But today, forgive me, cleanse me. Restore me into the family of God. I confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And I believe that God has raised him from the dead. And based on your most holy word, Romans chapter 10, verse 9, I am saved. Thank you for giving me your son, Jesus Christ, and the grace of God in my heart to change me. In Jesus' name, come on, say amen. Give the Lord a great hand clap of praise. Now, wait a minute. Hold. Stop that. Give the Lord a great hand clap of praise. There you go. Give him one. There you go. Give him one. Whenever people get saved, it's time to rejoice. Whenever people say yes to God, that's a great thing. That changed my life. Did it change your life? Let's give him another hand clap of praise. Come on. You hear? You hear?
I set out on a narrow way many years ago, hoping I would find true love along the broken road. But I got lost a time or two, wiped my brow and kept pushing through. I couldn't see how every sign pointed straight to you. That every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you. Yes, it did. I think about the years I spent just passing through. I'd like to have the time I lost and give it back to you. But you just smile and take my hand. You've been there, you understand. It's all part of a grander plan that is coming true. Every long lost dream led me to where you are. Others who broke my heart, they were like northern stars, pointing me on my way into your loving arms. This much I know is true, that God blessed the broken road that led me straight to you.
Stay small.
all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take, but more than anything. Yeah, more than anything. My wish for you is that this life becomes all that you want it to. Your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same things too. Yeah, this is my. That this life becomes